Good morning. Would you please smile at the person seated next to you and greet that person, Merry Christmas. And tell that person, you really do great today, okay? Say mo, there's something in you, parang gumaganda at pumupogi ka ata. Okay? And then saka mo batiin ang maligayang Pasko. Okay? All right. Once again, good morning, everyone. We are Victory and we are passionate for two things. Indeed, is to honor God and make disciples. So if you are new here, thank you for joining us. We hope this will not be your first, but this will not be, you know, the beginning of your new life together. Allow us to help you in your newfound faith, the new walk in the Lord. Allow us to help you grow in your walk with God. So you are very much welcome here. And if you are first time here, would you please raise your hand so that we could recognize you. Meron ba ngayon lang nakapunta? Raise up your hand. Palakpakan naman natin. First timers, wow, palakpakan natin. Welcome po. Thank you for joining us. Pero dito, palakpakan naman natin dito. Thank you. Na-meet ko pala sila this morning. No? Anyone, any more first timers? Huwag po kayo maglang, hindi po nagtitiktok. Okay, yung first time na pinapalakpakan po namin. So, once again, thank you for joining us here in our 10 a.m. service in Victory Pasig here in Estancia. And of course, those of us who are joining us online, thank you for worshiping the Lord with us, and we look forward to see you someday. Some of you are living outside Pasig, even outside of Metro Manila, even outside of the Philippines. Thank you for joining us, and we pray that we will continue to help you grow in your walk with the Lord. So for those of you who are new here, my name is Anthony, one of your pastors here in Victory Pasig. Pastor Mark is our lead pastor in the morning and also our senior pastor in Pasig. He is now, he's still in Canada ministering because our church is not just a local congregation, it's a global congregation. And our senior pastor is one of the apostolic leaders of our church. And maganda po nangyari, no? We have a lot of people from different places. And Pastor Mark has the privilege and an honor to minister there and equip our leaders in that nation. So we took a time to pray for him this morning, and also Pastor Jonathan, together with his kids, also in Guam, ministering there. So let's continue to cover them in prayers. Amen? So Pastor Mark and Pastor Jonathan, if you're watching, we prayed for you. Text ko na lang anong size. Okay? So nagpalakas pala, no? Siningit talaga yun para maisingit yung punchline. But anyway, again, welcome to Victory Pass. Again, before we proceed with the word, we will be having our Victory Weekend. Okay, if you've gone through one-to-one, or you're going through one-to-one, Victory Weekend is a two-day event, okay, that we do, okay, to be able to appropriate the victory that Christ has won for us on the cross. And this victory and this truth will help us, okay, to continue to grow and live a victorious life. So if you are part or you're going through one-to-one, please, you know, be excited on November 10 and 11, and join us in our Victory Weekend. Two-day retreat po yan. If kung meron po kayong mga mini-meet, please register them. And also, you can approach our admin staff. Okay, you can approach us to know more about our Victory Weekend. Amen? All right, so today, we are on our fourth week. Everybody say fourth week. Okay, fourth week na po tayo sa series natin entitled, What Shapes Us? Okay, it is a sixth-week series. And in this series, we have been talking about the statement of faith that we believe and hold on to as a church community. Okay, and we talk about what truly matters to us, especially as far as faith and doctrine and beliefs are concerned. The statement of faith is basically like a glue that holds us together, okay? And not just that, it promotes unity among us as church family. And this statement of faith is something that we hold on to, preach, okay? And basically provides an avenue for the church to talk about the doctrinal truths we hold on to and what we value. So the first week, we talk about the statement of God. Okay, the following, we talk about the creation and fall. And last week, I believe Pastor Jonathan and also in other services, Pastor Angelo, no, And Pastor Richard preached about the statement of faith of what we believe regarding Jesus Christ. And today, we're gonna talk about something. We're gonna talk very important, and that is the gospel. Everybody say the gospel. And how many of you enjoy the blessing because of the gospel? How many of you received the gospel already? That you live and breathe because of the gospel. And everything that we enjoy in this earth is basically because of the power of the gospel. And that is something that we're going to talk about today. So can I ask everyone to stand? And we will read our statement of faith when it comes to the gospel. And we'll be reading a passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 to 4. All right, you can read with me. It says here, we believe the gospel is the good news that God became man in Jesus Christ to reconcile lost people to himself. He lived a perfect, sinless life on our behalf and died on the cross for our sins. He was buried, and on the third day rose from the dead, securing our redemption forever, having triumphed over Satan and the forces of darkness. He ascended into heaven as the Lord of all. Everyone who repents and believes in him receives forgiveness of sins and eternal life. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 to 4 says, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scripture. This is the word of the Lord for us this morning. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us on the cross. Thank you that we are here today because of your grace in your compassion. And for some of us, Lord, who have been a believer and a Christian, Lord, thank you that we will never become so familiar with the gospel, but every single day we will allow the gospel to shape our lives. And for all of us, God, who are new in this faith, Lord, teach us, speak to us, transform us, so that every single day we will encounter the power of your grace. We honor you. We bless you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. We said several weeks ago that it is important to talk about something that will shape us. Okay? And what shape us is our series, because we believe that what is important to us is our belief, okay? And right belief will lead to right action, and wrong belief will lead to wrong action. And at the end of the day, what matters is what we believe, okay? And we are who we are today because of certain principles, certain beliefs, certain values that we hold on to from many years probably. And because what we believe determines how we live, then what we believe shapes and drives our behavior. And our belief, basically, our biblical belief of the gospel will basically impact the way we live our lives, and the way we pray, the way we approach God, and the way we relate to sin. And this series, or this particular topic about the gospel, is something very important, because we can never over become familiar with the gospel. Every single day, we need to preach the gospel to ourselves. And 1 Corinthians, the book of 1 Corinthians, is the first letter of Paul that he sent to his church or to God's church, to the people in Corinth, the church in Corinth, and he defined the gospel with three essential elements. It is about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When we say gospel, importante na maintindihan natin na siya ay namatay, siya ay nabuhay muli. Okay? At hindi lang yun, siya ay namatay, siya ay nilibing, okay? At siya ay nabuhay muli. And what is the significance of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection for us? And how can the message of the gospel really shapes our lives? Now, let me share with you two transformational truths about the gospel that we believe, we proclaim, and we demonstrate. Because the gospel is something that we believe and receive, and the gospel is something that we should constantly proclaim and declare, and every single day it's also something that we demonstrate so that everyone around us will also have an opportunity to hear and encounter the transformational power of the gospel in our life. Number one, the gospel is good news. Wow, very new to us. Well, we always hear that gospel is good news. Why the gospel is good news? In our statement of faith, we said that we believe the gospel is the good news that God became man in Jesus Christ. What's the purpose? To reconcile lost people to himself. He lived a perfect, sinless life on our behalf and died on the cross for our sins. John 1 verse 14 says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen His glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and full of truth." We said that Jesus Christ became man. God became man in the person of Jesus Christ so that He will live a life that we should have lived and died the death we should have died. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For our sake He made Him to be sin who knew no sin so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God." Why is it good news? Because left to ourselves, we can never be righteous. Apart from Christ, you will not be here today. Apart from the work of the gospel and the sacrifice of Christ, we can never experience transformation. We can never say no to sin. We can never have the ability to love God and even worship Him and trust Him and surrender everything to Him. What makes good news really good news? Have you ever thought about that? When you say the gospel is good news, what makes good news really good news? And I do believe a good news or good news becomes good news when we understand how bad the bad news is, right? And most of the time, we have an opportunity to receive good news. How many of you sometimes you receive text and say, "Good news! Good news, we have promos." Okay, good news, you have an opportunity to avail this. Parang every day there is good news. But how many of you would say that those good news are not really good news to you? You're not interested. Good news becomes a good news when you are in a situation that you are in a bad news. Now, imagine with me. Imagine with me that you need to go to an annual physical exam. Okay? You check up every year because it's required. Imagine with me, a doctor tells you that your annual physical exam is are all normal. Your sugar level are normal. Your blood sugar are normal. That your blood pressure are normal. Your creatinine level are normal. Lahat normal. Your organs are normal, living and functioning perfectly. How many of you would say it's a good news? Yes, right? But it's also yes and okay naman. Some of you will say okay lang if you're living a healthy lifestyle. Kung workout ka ng workout, binabantayan mo yung pagkain mo, vegan diet ka, hindi ka nagpupuyat, okay, may self-control ka sa cholesterol, sa sugar, okay, and that's your lifestyle, and you were commanded, instructed to go through annual physical exam, and the result was perfect and normal, it's a good news for you, but not really good news, because you're expecting a good news. Because that result is a fruit and a reward of your sacrifice and self-discipline. Now, what if you are living an opposite lifestyle? What if? Would you imagine it with me? What if iba? Ito, for illustration purposes lang. Hindi ito nangyayari. Walang ma-offend. What if hindi ka nag-workout? From ground floor to second floor, nag-elevator ka pa. Tas borderline na yung sugar level mo, hilig mo pa sa milk tea. Tapos yung cholesterol mo, alam mong meron kang lahi, yung lolo mo, parents mo, medyo kailangan bantayin yung cholesterol, pero excited ka lagi mag-samgyupsal. Tapos, every time nakakain, pinipigilan ka ng asawa mo, galit ka pa. Huwag mo nga akong pigilan. By illustration lang naman, no? For the sole purpose of illustration, may problem ka na sa uric acid, favorite mo pa trail mix. O, di ba? Now, unstable na yung BP natin. Pero puyat pa rin tayo ng puyat kasi K-drama is life. Now, ni-require kang mag-annual physical exam. Tapos nung lumabas yung annual physical exam, the doctor told you, Mr. Ong, I have a good news for you. Everything is normal. Good news becomes good news when you are in a situation that you know it's bad news. Church, the gospel is good news. Because Jesus did everything for our sake. We did not do anything to deserve His forgiveness, to deserve His love and forgiveness, yet He gave it to us anyway. We didn't do anything to deserve it. We didn't work for it. Jesus did the work so that we can enjoy it. The bad news is, we can never save ourselves. We can never attain God's favor no matter what we do and no matter how hard we try. And yet, Jesus reached out to us and saved us from the wrath of God. Why is the gospel good news? Because Jesus became man to reconcile us to Himself. Jesus lived a perfect and sinless life to die on the cross for our sins. Therefore, the gospel is good news for us because our salvation is planned in eternity by God and promised throughout Scripture. Bakit siya good news? Mga kapatid, there's nothing we can do. No matter how hard we try, but Jesus did it for us. God has already thought of His plan of redemption and salvation long before we even come here on earth. Plinano na ni Lord. Hindi po ito aksidente. That is why every single one of us, we experience being in a situation where we don't know what to do. We are in a desperate situation. And God used those situations so that we will humble ourselves and finally respond to God's invitation to receive His love and mercy. Salvation is something that God has planned for in eternity. Ano po alam niyo pang ibig sabihin nun? Naisip na ni Lord. Sino po sa inyo rito? Magulang. Hindi yung magulang ng gulang mo, magulang. Di ba pag magulang ka, pag meron kang anak na paparating, anong ginagawa natin? Planado na, tama po ba? Planado na. Nasa tiyan mo palang, inisip mo na mag-aaral to sa ganito. Wow, advance ang plano mo, kapatid. Di ba? Wala pa man pangalan, wala pa man gender, meron ka nang pangalan. Kung babae, ganito. Kung lalaki, ganito. Kung kambal, ay wag namang kambal sana, isa lang. Okay. Pero you have planned. Di ba? Pag pinanganak yan, meron ka lang inisip, anong susutin? Niready mo na, may crib na. Niready mo na yung damit niya. May sapatos na. Hindi pa man naglalakad, may sapatos na. Why? Because you planned it long before it became a reality. You know what? Our salvation is something that God has planned in eternity. And that plan that He devised is for Jesus to become man. For God to become man in Jesus Christ so that He will become the sacrifice for our sins that will bring about forgiveness and salvation. God loves us so much and doesn't want to punish us. But God is just and must punish sin. And that's why He sent Jesus, His one and only Son. And that's the power of the cross. The cross is the perfect expression of God's love for humanity through Jesus Christ's death and sufferings. There's no way we can get out of the problem, like He said. There's no way that we can get out of the problem of sin, but God has devised a plan by sending His Son Jesus Christ to die on the cross, to pay the penalty of our sins, taking the punishment that we deserve so that we can receive forgiveness and be reconciled to God. Jesus' death is a requirement for our redemption. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 to 4 says, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you receive, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures." Jesus' life, death, and resurrection earned our salvation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, chapter 5, verse 21, "For our sake He made no sin who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God." Because Jesus Christ died on the cross, our sins are atoned for. Napagbayaran po ang mga kasalanan natin. Atonement is the work of Christ, or the work Christ did in His life and death to earn our forgiveness and salvation. And this atonement is a requirement and necessary for Christ to come to live in us, to die for us, and to rise from the dead, to display the love of God and to fulfill the promise of God for salvation. Therefore, we can say that gospel is good news because only God can save us. Only God can save us. Kahit ano pong gawin natin, kahit magpakabait po tayo, hindi po kayang bayaran ng pagsisimba natin, ang kabaitan natin, kahit gaano tayo ka-generous, the only way for us, the only way for God's wrath to be appeased is for Jesus Christ to pay the penalty and to die on the cross, to receive those sacrifices, that He will be brutally bruised and killed to pay the penalty of our sin. Two transformational truths about the gospel that we believe, proclaim, and demonstrate the gospel's good news. Second, the gospel has lasting impact. It's not just the good news that you hear. This good news will shape your life. This good news will dictate the way we live our lives. This good news shapes our living, our thinking. And because this gospel shapes us and has lasting impact, we live a missional life, a transformed life. The gospel not just help us inform, but be transformed every single day. Look at our statement, having triumphed over Satan and the forces of darkness, He ascended into heaven as Lord of all. Everyone who repents and believes in Him receives forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Ephesians 1 verse 7 says, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of His grace. That's the very reason why Jesus came here on earth. Jesus' blood was poured out for the forgiveness of our sins. Why? Because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And Christ's suffering brought redemption, freed us from the bondage of sin, and Christ's death bore the wrath of God and restored our broken relationship with the Father caused by sin. The gospel is good news, and the gospel has lasting impact because Jesus' sacrifice paid the penalty for our sin. And do you know that to be forgiven is one of the greatest need of men? Provision is important. Healing is important. Good health is important. But do you know that forgiveness is one of our greatest need? Do you still remember when you hurt someone? Do you still remember when you did something that you knew forgiveness and something that you have to earn? Do you still remember the time when you committed something, maybe deliberate or not, maybe sinasadya mo, or sabihin natin biktima ka lang? Do you remember those days that you are pleading, appealing, begging for forgiveness? And why you want that? Because you knew forgiveness is something that you need, because every single day that burden that you carry and the guilt that you bear is just too heavy. You cannot sleep, you cry, you are condemned. You are somehow thinking, if I could only turn back time, if I can only do something to be forgiven, if I can only have the opportunity to start all over, then this relationship will be salvaged. Do you still remember those times when you need forgiveness? Ang bigat di po ba? Kapag may kasalanan tayo, ang hirap. And minsan ang statement natin, anong pwede kong gawin? Please, tell me, what shall I do to earn your forgiveness? And yet, think about it for a moment, how much more when we receive forgiveness from a holy, righteous, and powerful God. Christ's death on the cross has lasting impact on our lives because we knew we don't deserve that forgiveness. And yet, because of His compassion and grace, we are here today. We can worship Him. I like what we're worshiping. I like that we're worshiping this morning. Because sabi ng Lord, I know, Lord, that the past is past, Lord. You take delight in seeing me, Lord. I know I'm no longer what I used to be. I'm no longer who I used to be, Lord. Thank you because of your forgiveness. That maybe people will not accept you. Maybe people won't believe you because of your past. But God, look at us not based on our past, but based on what Christ has done for us on the cross. In fact, He knew our past and loved us the same. How amazing that is. How transformational that truth is for us, understanding the power of the gospel. And you know what? When you always reflect on that, ponder on that, then the gospel is not something that you just take it for granted, that you take for granted. It's a good news. And it has lasting impact on us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life." When you read that scripture and you understand who you were and what Christ did for you and for me, then this verse is not just words, are not just words. This verse is a good news. This verse is a promise. This verse, this scripture, is a living word that brings transformation to each one of us. Therefore, the gospel is allowing us to understand the gravity of our sin against God and the greatness of His provision. That we are here today because of that provision. The gospel is good news and has a lasting impact to those who believe and receive it by faith. Because Jesus is God, He has the power to forgive and save us from our sins and give us eternal life. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 to 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." The gospel not only offers redemption and secures our eternal life, it also promises freedom and victory. Because Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead, He proves that even death could not hold Him down. Even death cannot overcome Him. If Jesus' death is a requirement for our redemption, if Jesus needed to die so that we can be redeemed, then His resurrection is a declaration of our victory. Because the God that we worship is alive, therefore we as His people will also live a victorious life. We don't worship a God who is dead. We don't worship a God who is weak. We don't worship a God who is defeated. We worship a God who is victorious. Would you say amen? And therefore, every believer who believes in Christ, every Christian who put their faith in Jesus Christ on what He has done on the cross, believe that He died, buried, and resurrected, then all of us can live a victorious life. All of us can live in freedom. All of us have the power and the ability to say no to sin. All of us have the capacity to forgive other people and release forgiveness. But however, we will say, ang hirap magpatawad, Pastor. Ang hirap ng ginawa niya sa akin. But because we trust in the grace of God, because we trust in the power and the strength of God living inside of us, then by His grace and strength, we can still have that ability to release forgiveness. Because Jesus triumphed over Satan and the forces of darkness. Church, we can live victorious life. Faith is possible for us. Because we go to Jesus, we pray to Jesus that someone that we know who can sympathize with us, someone that we know who is powerful and alive. What is a picture of someone who lives a victorious life? Like He said, that person can overcome sin. That person can say no to sin. That person understood that he's no longer defeated, but a victorious believer. If a person understands the victory that Christ has won on the cross for us, then we can have faith even in the midst of sufferings. Sometimes when we go through sufferings, we cannot understand, we question God. But do you know that even Jesus Christ also suffered? Do you realize that Christ has to go through everything? And yet, even as he went through everything, died and mocked and bruised, He died, He was buried, and yet He resurrected from the dead. That is something that in a way would say, dead end for us. Diba? Kasi pagpatay ang isang tao, wala ka na magagawa. Do you realize that? Pag na-inlove ka at na-broken heart ka, anong pwede mong gawin? Magmahal muli. Sakit mo na magsayo pa. Ganun lang ba kadali mag-move on? Now here's my point. If you're broken-hearted, as painful as it is, believe me, I know it's painful. When I say painful, mahirap po talaga ang broken heart. Pero hindi ko po na-experience yun. Okay. No, so. What I'm trying to say is, when someone is broken-hearted, you can say, trust me, I say this with humility and compassion, you can say that it's not the end for that person. Because you know, one day, maybe someone will come along and that you will have an opportunity to love someone again, right? Yes. Right? Diba? Kaya nga masaya si Jordan. Diba? Kung ikaw, negosyante, diba? Na-bankrupt ka, mahirap, masakit. Lord, bakit? Ba't may nalaw to? But because you're still alive, you just know it's not the end for you. Because you'll never know, one day God will open door for you. Because life is still there. Can you say amen? But if you are dead, it's the end. There's no more chance. But you know what? We are dead because of our sin. And truly, there's no hope for us. But because of what Christ has done. Because he alive, he was alive, because he resurrected from the grave. He gave us life in us. He gave us an opportunity to live again. Jesus resurrected, and his resurrection allow us to have that reset button. Allow us to be revived again and start anew. Jesus is alive and victorious. And because he is alive and victorious, his resurrection is the hope of every believer. We can also live a victorious life. I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what challenges you are experiencing. I don't know what strongholds you encounter every day. But let me tell you this. We are called to be victorious. Not because of our ability, but because of what Christ has done for us. His resurrection and his death and his resurrection not just provided salvation and forgiveness and healing, it also provided victory, strength, hope, understanding that in Christ we can do everything. And it's my prayer that when you're going through something in difficulty, ponder on the gospel. Understand how victorious we are, how strong we are because of the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. Amen? Colossians 1, verse 12 to 13 says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light, he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. Jesus said, it is finished. And because it is finished, we are all qualified to receive his eternal life and forgiveness. And as I end, because Jesus has triumphed over Satan and the forces of darkness, ascended into heaven as Lord of all, we can have victory over sin and death. And the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ has made us victorious in life. Church, we're not marching towards victory. We are marching from victory. Even before the battles begin, you are already victorious. Even if sin is lurking around you, you are already victorious. The enemy is defeated. And therefore, we don't say, Lord, help me to overcome because I cannot. You can. Through the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. When we understand the transformational power of the gospel, it is good news. And it is also has lasting impact in us. We believe it. We proclaim it. And we demonstrate it. Can I ask everyone to stand as we worship the Lord today? And we will take communion right after in response to God's message for us today. And as we worship the Lord and take communion, I want all of us, each one of us, to take a personal moment with the Lord and thank Him for His compassion, His grace, His love, and His forgiveness. Let's worship the Lord.
death gives way to glorious light and tears away the chains that bind. No sons and daughters in your eyes, you look upon us with delight. Oh Allah, how can it be? From that cross you look at me. Oh Allah, pour out for me. What a beautiful love. What a beautiful love, so glorious, came down unashamed, you call me yours, caught up in your grace, you're all I need. There's nothing more beautiful than your love. So glorious, came down unashamed, you call me yours, caught up in your grace, you're all I need, there's nothing more than your love, oh our love, come on, lift him up.
Thank you, Jesus, for your beautiful love, your constant love, your never-changing love for each one of us, Lord. Truly, we are here today because of the power of the gospel. The gospel reminds each one of us, Lord, the gravity of our sin. In the greatness of God's provision that leads to salvation, forgiveness, and victory for each one of us. And Lord, today we want to remember, we want to, Lord, be grateful for what you have done for us. And right now, let's take our communion elements. We want to make sure that we do this together as a church family, as a church community. If you do not have communion element, you can raise your hand so that our ushers can give one to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 23 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'It is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Lord, thank you for this bread that symbolizes your body that was pierced, wounded, crushed, bruised so that we can be forgiven. And today, Lord, thank you for allowing your body to be broken so that we can be made whole. Thank you for the wholeness that you have given us, Lord, through your sacrifice. But it doesn't really matter if we have everything in this life materially. It doesn't matter if our job is a dream job. It doesn't matter how much we have money in the bank. What's important, Lord, is you have answered our greatest need, and that's our need for forgiveness. Thank you that we can stand here today forgiven because of your body that was pierced. Let's take and partake of the bread. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Lord, thank you for the cup that symbolizes your blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins, cleansing us, Lord, from all unrighteousness and impurities. Thank you, Lord, because of your blood, we were not just forgiven, but we were purified. That in you, Lord, every time we come to you, we don't look at our past, but we look at us as sons and daughters of the living God, righteous, blameless, and holy before you. Thank you that through your blood, we can experience freedom and victory over sin. That through your blood, we can also experience healing of every sickness and disease. But we honor you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, because you became man. You went through suffering. You went through temptation, yet without sin. You were persecuted. You were maligned, Lord, because you experienced all those things, Lord. We know that you can also relate to each one of us whenever we go through trials. And because you became man just like us, there's an assurance that you hear us, Lord, in whatever we go through in life. Lord, thank you for your suffering that brought about salvation and victory in us. Let's partake of the cup. Praise God. Our God is faithful, amen. Our God is good and loving God. And as before we pray and send everyone with a blessing, there's one thing that I want to pray for. Let's continue in the posture of prayer. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. I know we just did a communion this morning. But if you're here today, you're saying, "Lord, I know you, but I do not have a personal relationship with you. But before I leave this place, I want to make a decision to make you my Lord and Savior, to surrender my life to you. Lord, I am sick and tired of being the boss of my life, but today, I want to give it to you. I want to surrender it to you. And I want to receive you as my Lord and Savior." As every eye closed and every head bowed, if that's your prayer, Would you please repeat this prayer after me? Say this with all of your heart. Lord Jesus, thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for the opportunity today to receive you in my life. I am a sinner, and there's nothing I can do to be saved and to be forgiven. But today, Lord, I want you to come into my life to be my Lord, Master, and Savior. I put my faith on what you have done on the cross for the forgiveness of my sins, and you rose again after 3 days to give me eternal life. I receive you today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. If you pray that prayer, how many of you pray that prayer? If you pray that prayer, would you please raise your hand so that we can rejoice with you? Anyone here, we don't want to embarrass you or anything. We want to celebrate with you. Anyone here who prayed that prayer? You, with all of your heart, pray that prayer, receiving Jesus in your life and putting your faith in what He has done on the cross for us. Anyone here, you pray that prayer? Anyone here? We just want to rejoice with you and celebrate with you. Anyone? Praise God. If you don't want to raise your hand, it's okay. But if you pray that prayer, please do not leave this place without asking the person who invited you, or come here in front so that we can pray for you. Our pastors are here. Pastor Bong is here. Our leaders are here. Herlim is here. One of our campus missionaries, so that we can stand with you and celebrate with you. Amen? Praise God. Lord, thank you for your word today. We leave this place blessed, ministered, refreshed, and loved by you once again. Thank you, God. Bless your people. May the love of Jesus, may the love of God and the fellowship, may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.